Well, it seems the more that the televangelist tries to put space between her ministry and Christopher Coleman, the more there are things that seems to drag her in closer and closer. How things went. Neighbors heard arguing sometime around 3 o'clock in the morning. When Christopher Coleman called the police, he did not call the police station. He called a neighbor who happens to be a policeman. There's a few policemen in that neighborhood, and that's why they have are willing to put up these surveillance cameras just for their own safety. So don't expect, and the fact also that the Colemans, the husband and wife, had started putting together a business that was supposed to be help, it was Executive Solutions or something like that. And you read the description and it's, you know, very, very elite sounding and, you know, very official sounding. And, but what it is, it's selling surveillance cameras. And that was the business. The business apparently, they failed. It was started up in January of 08. And he never filed an income tax return or a statement of income. And so it was no longer active. All the writing in red, in the red paint, they're pretty certain to be just a cover-up. And the comments that ran along the lines, deny your God, I am almost certain that they were to appeal to the church membership, that they were being persecuted and that this would align the church members on their side. And I don't think that's going to be the case, but you never know. This quit claim that the wife signed, or allegedly signed, we don't know that. We don't know that at all. Because when you are next to such wealth as we're talking about, you can have fixers. You can have people solve problems for you and get you, you know, get passports and, you know, all sorts of things like that. So you have to follow it through and see if it's legitimate. The wife was she was an MP herself, military police, you know, only through the Navy, where he was through the Marines, and that's how they met, sharing MP duty. So she was no pushover. So I imagine that when he went to strangle her, she put up a real fight. And she was capable of doing that after, you know, being in the military. Let's see here. I've got all these notes, you know, scribbled notes in the margins, and so I have to struggle reading this. They found the secret post office box with a greeting card in there from St. Petersburg post, with a St. Petersburg postmark. So I'm sure that is probably the girlfriend. I have known who the girlfriend was for a few days and just didn't want to reveal it because something wasn't right, and I didn't want to make her name public. But it is public now. It's Tara Lenz. And he gave her quite a line. She's cooperating fully with the police, and in fact, immediately called up the police here few days ago and said, I just received an email, and she, you know, told the police about it. But she was, he was telling her, and this is important to keep in mind, he was telling her things that were are very easily disproven, i.e. that that they would, he was divorced just recently, and that they could get married next January or something. I can't remember when that was. But this whole thing was just, it's a matter of public record, and it wouldn't, she could, which tells me the fact that it is so easily disproven, that he was just stringing her along, that he never had any intentions of marrying her. And quite frankly, I think that it would have been necessary for him to kill her, because she could have, she would have no too much about him and could testify against him. And these Scott Peterson types, you know, we had Amber Frye, and she cooperated as long as she could with the police until the police felt it was no longer safe for her to keep seeing him. Because sooner or later, Scott Peterson was going to have to kill her. And just like I think that Christopher Coleman would probably have to kill what this girl, it would cross his mind that that would solve that problem. And following along that train of thought, that the way you get solve problems is to get rid of the people. Let's take a look at Pastor Ron Coleman. That is the father of Christopher Coleman and the father-in-law of Sherry Coleman. He helped unload the house. And Christopher was living, had gone back to his parents and was living and was staying in their house during this time between the murders and when he was arrested. So this this Ron Coleman, pastor of Grace Church, he was a part of that business of removing all of Sherry's and the boys' stuff and never offering them to the in-laws, never, not a phone call, nothing of condolences or anything. There was just nothing. So like son, so is the father, as far as my opinion goes. He helped empty that out, and I mean, how low can you go, you know? That's just my opinion. I think the Sherry's parents and the grandparents of the boys were treated horribly, and a pox on them. Now, with the search warrant, the police found, well, of course, all that writing on the wall, you know, the deny your God garbage. That is for the parishioners of, you know, that is to endear the congregation to him, and how brave he is that he fought off these big bad men or something, who knows. And he was being tortured for his faith. Well, let's see, another thing is, so all that stuff on the walls was just a cover up. And meanwhile, Ron Pastor Ron Coleman has sent out emails asking for donations. Oops, too far.